I'd like to look at two different perspectives. One is that of international scientific collaboration. And there, I think we've done better than in the past. And the other is the international sort of institutional system response. And then, of course, we've failed. With regard to scientific collaboration, I'd like to say that the Chinese consortium published the genomic sequence of the new virus in GenBank, which is a public bank of data, on January 5, 2020. And the sequencing of the genome and then the dissemination of the data obviously enabled the development of assays to diagnose COVID-19 and triggered vaccine research and research on monoclonal antibodies and so on. And that is different in the past. Remember, in 2005, Indonesia withholding H5N1 sequence, fearing that if it provides the sequence to the world, that would lead to a vaccine made by, let's say, Americans, and then the United States selling it, or firms saying selling it at prices that would be unaffordable to the developing world. Another, I think, striking example of a remarkable and unprecedented open science collaboration is the amount of papers. It's 100,000 scientific reports in a year, and this new way of disseminating rapidly science with unrefereed preprints that has pluses and minuses. I'm not going into that. But I really find, from a scientific perspective, scientific international collaboration as very different and much better than in the past. In contrast, of course, as others have said, the international institutional system has failed. The system to respond to early warnings, and the so-called Independent Panel for Pandemic Preparedness and Response, IPPPR, of which I was a member, concluded that the alert system didn't operate with sufficient speed, that the legally binding international health regulations are more constraining rather than facilitating rapid action, and that the precautionary principle was not applied when the public health emergency of international concern declaration by the WHO DG was then declared too late. Not only was it declared maybe let's say a week or 10 days too late, but the main fact is that it was not followed by any forceful and immediate emergency responses in most countries, despite the evidence. Only a minority of countries set in motion coordinative measures. But for most countries, February 2020 was a lost month. So a failure in the system. Then, of course, a failure in the international political community. The Security Council, remember, met in March 2020 and failed to adopt a resolution, China being reluctant for the Council to get involved, saying it was not within its mandate, while the US were insisting that any Council action should refer to the origins of the virus as the Chinese virus. And this is in sharp contrast with what happened in HIV/AIDS, when the world came for the first time together with a Security Council resolution and UN General Assembly special session 2001, a session that is now occurring every 5 years to monitor international progress in the fight against HIV. And then the Ebola resolution that was unanimously adopted in December 2014 to respond to the Ebola crisis, and calling to countries of the world to refrain from isolating the affected countries. Another feature of the failure of the institutional system to me is the failure of the Executive Board of the World Health Assembly, which is basically the governing board of the World Health Assembly to meet until October 2020. Can you imagine any company, you know, about in a major crisis not calling on its board until for 6 months? Then, of course, there were the delays and failures in delivery of funding by the international funding institutions, World Bank, International Monetary Fund. And then there is the vaccine crisis that we're discussing today, the stark contrast between what's happening in the rich countries and the developing countries. And these inequalities, I agree with what has been said so far, are fueled by a combination of the current saturation of the manufacturing capacity. We'll come back to that possibly, except maybe in China. Vaccine nationalism, which you mentioned, by wealthy governments securing 4.3 billion doses of vaccines for a population of 1.16 billion people. And then a COVAX system that is not an inclusive system, that is not a global system. And the fact that our international current system lacks an what we call in, you know, in our report of the panel, an end-to-end international system with R&D, clinical trials, manufacturing processes, guided by the goal and strategy for equitable and effective access. Whereas at this time, in the current model, corporations develop with a lot of public funding a product, then they sell these proprietary products to wealthy country markets, and they leave the rest of the world dependent on the goodwill of donors, development assistance, charity, to eventually gain access to those life-saving health technologies. That model cannot continue.